what does it take to turn audacious goals into reality? You know, the way I look at it, there are three ways to solve a problem. The first is to ignore it. At least the problem is not solved, but it's in your mind, maybe solved somewhere, so you can ignore it. The second is to create a solution for the problem. So the problem still exists, but you are creating a solution for it. And the third way to solve a problem is actually to dissolve it. You make a systemic change so strong that the problem, the possibility of that problem ever existing, is not even an option anymore. And that is what I want to talk about next. And what am I talking about? I'm of course talking about polio eradication in India. Do you know that in 2009, we had more than half of world's cases of polio? And just 4 years later, India was completely polio-free. And this is a huge achievement that has been made through efforts that have taken decades of work. Professor Ram of Public Health Foundation of India, who has had the ringside view in this whole eradication process. And in conversation with him, I invite Mr. Vijay Mahajan, a man who needs no introduction. So over to you, sir.
I can't remember whether it was last year or 2 or 3 years ago when Sankalp showed a film on Dabbawalas. And we actually had the head of the Dabbawala Union at the event. Well, Ramanan, how many Dabbawalas deliver every year in Mumbai?
About 73 million.
And how many vaccines do children have to be delivered in India?
About 400 million.
Well, so that sets the stage. We're going to talk about ambition in this session. Ambition in the context of a wide dispersed public system spread all over India, and where indeed the maximum problem is the one which is the remotest, the most difficult to reach, where all the low-hanging fruit has long ago been plucked. And as you know, we were all lucky, even my generation, that smallpox was nearly eradicated. It was eradicated finally when I was in school. We benefited from that. But in front of our eyes, polio was finally, India was declared polio free last year. And Professor Ramanan's team from the Public Health Foundation of India was involved with the final stages of that, developing very rigorous routines for monitoring and surveillance, because as a disease gets rarer and rarer, the tighter does have to be the monitoring and surveillance to figure out even the last 1 in 10,000 cases or 1 in 1 million cases. But that's not where the story ends. In fact, it begins. And he is now one of the architects of Project Indradhanush, which is an attempt to immunize India's children against 7 deadly diseases. And I'd like you to start by telling us as to what that implies, Professor Ramanan.
Thank you, Vijay. And thanks for having me. So obviously, the elimination of polio in India has been a huge public health success, because that requires immunization at the scale of the entire country. But there is a routine immunization program as well, which often gets forgotten about, which is that children need to get about 7 vaccines, vaccines against 7 diseases in the first year of life, at birth, 6 weeks, 10 weeks, 14 weeks, and then at 9 months. And many of these diseases still kill. Now, polio was able to get rid of one of these diseases, but there are still the other 6. And we haven't really gotten rid of polio entirely. We still need to move to an injectable vaccine. Now, of the 27 million children that are born every year, a full third of them don't actually get the full complement of these vaccines. So a lot of children die unnecessarily before the age of 1, a lot before the age of 5, because they didn't get all of these vaccines. So polio was a success achieved in a campaign mode. We got millions of vaccinators out, got these polio drops into children into their mouths, sometimes more than one time, maybe multiple times. Now that is done, we are now moving on to this much more ambitious goal of routine immunization. Routine immunization is literally, I think I've described it as the biggest delivery challenge we have in the country. It's much more than Dabbawalas or FedEx or DHL or any of those, because It requires going to every last village. It requires getting these 7 vaccines into these children using a needle, which, you know, mothers are not always very happy with. In a particular sequence, you can't immunize a child twice against DTP, the wrong dose. It has to be exact same 3 doses. And it has to be done at that correct time with, you know, gaps between when you actually do it. So in a sense, this is a very complex delivery challenge. And also, it requires these vaccines to be kept in a cold chain the entire time, that from when they manufactured all the way to when they go to the very end. So I'd love to, you know, borrow skills of someone like Anirudh, who was here before, to figure out where we can find technological fixes. But at the end of the day, the ambition is also of a management fix, which is how do you really make sure that these vaccines get into not just most of the children, but really all of the children in the country.
Yeah. So just to re-emphasize the 2-3 things that you said which caught my imagination. One is that the vaccine has to be, the set of 7 vaccines have to be given at specific ages of the children. And once you miss it beyond a certain window, then it's kind of not effective. And
the child gets a disease, so.
Okay. Yeah. So that's a huge problem. So it's, the second is that the vaccine has to be, from the time it's manufactured to the time it's actually injected, it has to be maintained at a specific temperature range, and that's between what and what?
So it's it's 3 degrees to 7 degrees for most of the vaccines, and then sub 20 to sub 30 for polio.
And this, and what is the longest duration for which the cold chain can be broken?
So the cold chain is it has some flexibility in the upside, so you can get the vaccines out of the cold chain, and you can't keep it at too high a temperature, but for a little while it can be off. But one problem we identified early in this process was that if you freeze the vaccine, even for a very short period of time, then the vaccine is essentially dead. So too high a temperature is bad, even more dangerous, too low a temperature is bad.
So we have to worry about timing, we have to worry about temperature, and we have to worry about the vast territory that it has to be delivered. So it's not really dabbawala, it's like delivering gourmet thalis at different stages to different households all over the country.
Even more complex, because you deliver a gourmet thali, I'm sure everyone in the audience will accept a gourmet thali and be happy to eat it. Now you tell a mother who's never seen her child sick, and you tell her, I'm going to poke this long needle into your firstborn who is still so small and vulnerable to protect against a disease that you may have never seen. That is truly a challenge, because the fear of vaccines is significant.
So you did talk about the technology challenge and the management challenge, but is there also a behavioral change challenge? I mean, do parents cooperate?
Well, some cooperate, others don't. Some have to be encouraged, and
So how do you do that?
Well, some of it is communication. So I don't know, if you go out of this building, if you go to all the bus stops and all of that, you see on the radio and the TV, the Prime Minister and then the Health Minister launched his Mission Indradhanush, which was a very ambitious campaign to get at those last 9.5 million children who are not fully immunized. So some of it is a behavioral part. Before our campaign
nine
used
and
to
a half every year, I assume.
Every year. Every year. So, yes. The birth cohort is about 45 million children.
Right. Yeah.
See, before our campaign used to be, or our messaging used to be, it wasn't done in this active way. It was always vaccinate your child. That really doesn't mean very much. If you ask, is your child vaccinated? He says, sure, they got some vaccine. But then we went back and saw, what does that really mean to mothers? They just thought, well, if I got a couple of vaccines in, even if it wasn't my child getting fully immunized, that's sufficient. So we've now changed the entire messaging to be fully immunize your child. So it's fully immunize every child is a tagline. The Twitter handle is vaccinate for life with a 4, vaccinate for life. So that's, again, part of the messaging. The second is the messaging for the ASHAs and the A&M workers. This is a program that is not operating through campaigns. It is operating through the frontline health workers, and the vast majority of them who are out in these rural areas, and getting them to make sure that they make the sell, that this is something that is really required. The last part is, if you're selling...
Just to give a sense to the audience which may not be familiar with public health systems, ASHAs are the accredited social health activists, and how many are there around the country?
So there's a total of about 200,000 health workers, including ASHAs, A&Ms, and all of the other frontline workers. So the auxiliary nurse midwives, the A&Ms, are the ones who actually hand out the vaccine. There's the Anganwadi workers who also deliver the integrated child development service program,
right.
And then there's the ASHAs.
And of course, none of them report to you.
No.
Right? So how do you actually influence positive behavior in a public system where we know that, for example, incentives are rare, recognition is rare, the line of command is, sort of two or three layers away from your advice. How do you manage this complexity?
So in a couple of ways, how many of you have seen a picture of a soldier and know what that person does in the country? Come on, all of you, right? You've all seen pictures of sign up for the army. How many of you knows what an A&M worker really is? Or has seen a picture of an auxiliary nurse midwife? I see two, three. But in a public space, in a hoarding, recognized in any way, we don't really recognize these people. They are the frontline health workers. They are the guardians of, of the country's well-being in the most direct way possible. So the entire communication campaign is designed to put them as the face of the campaign. So the next phase, the first phase has been about, this evil eye and, to encourage mothers to get their children vaccinated. The second phase is entirely about incentivizing them. You can pay people, but recognition of the important role that they have is something we haven't really done, and this is the major shift in the operational strategy. Along with that, they do get financial incentives. ASHA workers do get paid 150 to 250 rupees for every child that's fully immunized. But sometimes they don't necessarily know that they have the incentives or not able to access them. So again, we're figuring out ways to make sure that they can, get at those incentives. But it is a challenge. When you have a country with the vastness that we have, you can't design solutions from Delhi and expect it to work everywhere. It really has to be very decentralized innovation. And a critical part is to not over-engineer the system, but to really leave the flexibilities for some of the engineering to happen on the ground.
So just in terms of sheer numbers of vulnerability, smallpox now kind of history, polio also that. So with the remaining six diseases, because polio is still one of the seven, what is the annual level of morbidity in the absence of the vaccination program not happening?
So let me give you some numbers. 1.4 million children die every year before already. The first 5 years of life. 1.4 million now. It's come down from about 1.9 that we used to have about 10 years ago. Of the 1.4 million children, we can probably save about 150,000 to 200,000 lives, avert those deaths right now, if we scaled up the program, which we hope to do within the next 24 months. So 200,000 children would not die. But that is not all. If we build this vaccine system for the 21st century, we can then add other vaccines like the pneumococcal vaccine, like the rotavirus vaccine, like perhaps even adult vaccines, that could save far more lives than even the 500 or 600,000, in the next round. So
we'll settle for 200,000. That's a lot of lives saved. So we just have three more minutes. Are there any questions from the Twitter feed or from the
audience?
Volunteers?
Any questions?
There's one coming, I guess. Swamiji, you want to ask? Okay, till that comes, go ahead, please, as an exception. Yeah. No, we'll get him another mic.
He's on. I just read last week about this vaccine. And then I read another news from British scientists or doctors, someone has researched that there'll be one or two biscuits the children can eat every day once, and the polio will be eradicated. It's true? Just one last week I read it in the newspaper.
I'm not familiar with this polio biscuit, Swamiji, but
then I'll send you the polio biscuit, this information. I think it'll be great, another invention.
Right.
I'll send you this news.
Sure.
Yes, thank you.
Well, that certainly would, if it is true, it'll be the basis of several development enterprises around the country. So, any questions, Twitter or Twitter feed?
There's one there.
Yes, yes.
Can someone get a mic there?
Where? Sorry, I can't.
Hello?
Yeah, go ahead.
Hello, can you hear me? Okay.
We can hear you.
Hello?
Yes, yeah. It's very directional, so speak like this.
Okay. So my question is that how does PHFI collaborate with social innovators to solve the problems that they see on field? So let's say there's an engineering tech startup that would sort of help PHFI to build in a mechanism, or let's say a service or a product. How does that mechanism work? Does anybody from the PHFI have like formal relations with startups, engineering startups or product-based startups? Specifically, let's say for the vaccine temperature and timing thing that you mentioned, so on that scale as such, do you collaborate with startups to deliver such products and help?
Thanks for the question. So PHFI runs a unit called the Immunization Technical Support Unit, which essentially supports the routine immunization program, which is run out of Nirman Bhavan, just two or three buildings up from here. So this is about 50 people who are essentially dealing with all aspects of the program, the communications, program operations, et cetera. There is also an innovations unit, which does try to take on board innovations that could be piloted first and then taken on scale. Keep in mind that anything that we're trying to do here has to work at least at the scale of about 5 or 10 million population and then scale up from there, at least to a state and much greater. So we do prefer things that are at least at that scale, or there's proof of principle at that scale, rather than starting with something which is, you know, just the idea. But certainly if you have those ideas, you can Google me and you can send it to me.
Well, that gets us to the end of the time, but there is one Twitter question which you are an absolute expert on, which is, are children receiving the vaccination being tracked? And if you could just 30 seconds.
Sure, you know, that's a really good question. One of the most important determinants of whether a child has gotten a vaccine is whether they have a vaccination card at all to begin with. So I'm sure for most of you in this audience, if you have children, the children have been vaccinated. But if you have maids, if you have drivers, find out if they actually have a vaccination card, because that is the way in which we track whether children have gotten vaccinated. We do track the vaccines now on a pilot basis, so now we know exactly where the vaccines are going, what temperature they're being kept, but we don't have any sort of electronic method for really tracking whether a particular child got the vaccine in any specific way. So the card is essential, and it's important to get the word out that these are something that every child really should have.
Thank you very much, and I very much recommend that you see Professor Ramanan give a TED talk. It's on TEDx, TEDx Gateway, and I saw it before this, and it is really very riveting. I don't think we did full justice to all your great work. Thank you very much.